Good morning, church. Welcome. Come on down through the doors if you're joining with us online this morning. Welcome. As we gather together to praise the name of Jesus, my worship team is somewhere in the building. They will come. It's great to have you all along this morning with us as we come to praise the name of Jesus. We come with varying roads to the service this morning. We've all walked different journeys, yet we come and we gather here in Jesus' name, and we come and edify and glorify his body to encourage one another and to lift up. So let us stand as we come to worship him this morning. May we come with thanksgiving in our hearts, with joy, with the knowledge of Jesus Christ here and alive in us. Amanda's going to read to us from Psalm 147. Let us hear the word of God. Please stand.
Praise the Lord. How good is it to sing praises to our God? How pleasant and fitting to praise him. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars and calls them each by name. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble, but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music to our God on the harp. He covers the sky with clouds. He supplies the earth with rain and makes grass grow on the hills. He provides food for the cattle and for the young ravens when they call. His pleasure is not in the strength of the horse, nor his delight in the legs of a man. The Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love.
How good is our God, that he provides for us, that he loves us, that he cares for us, that he gave his only son for us. May we worship him here in this place. May we raise our voices as we sing. May we let our praises ring. Let us sing with thankful hearts. Let us praise his name.
Oh Lord, my God, in you I put my trust. Oh Lord, my God, in you I put my hope.
Yes, we do.
Oh Lord, my God, in you I put my trust. Oh Lord, oh Lord, my God. Our hearts again, increase in us we pray.
continue to move amongst us as we meet here in this place. May he receive all glory and honor due his name. Amen. Please be seated. Great to have you all along this morning with us. Welcome once again to the Mount Gambier Baptist Church as we come to glorify and edify the name of Christ, to build one another up as we meet together. This morning, I've been asked by Cam, who is away celebrating their 20th anniversary of marriage, which is really great, so you can give them a pat on the back when you see them again, to remind you guys about next week. Who can tell me what's happening next week? Baptism. Fantastic. So we at the moment have one candidate for baptism. If you are interested, or if it is part of your journey, or if you don't really know what baptism means or what it's about, then please come and find one of the elders, your friends, your family members, somebody in your house church, and have a conversation with them. We have the opportunity to fill this baptistry up here, which takes a few thousand litres in there. I think there's at least two pods, maybe, thereabouts. So it'd be great to utilise that time and to share in the joy that is baptism. It is through faith that we have been saved. And it is by baptism that we identify ourselves to the death and resurrection of Jesus in our lives, to publicly declare that he is Lord and Savior over our lives. We have forgiveness of sin and we have life in him. So if this is part of your journey, if you know a friend or somebody who's been wondering about baptism, then please gather them and catch up with Cam or myself or Adam or anybody, really. We all have a testimony and we all have a story to tell. We all have an opportunity to come and support one another in our walk in faith. So if baptism is part of your journey now, then please make the time and catch up and join us next week as we come to celebrate together the baptism of another believer. I'm going to invite Annette to come and speak to us about a women's event.
Welcome all the well women and women of worth online and also here. I'd like to invite you all to our next women's ministry event. It's sewing, knitting and natter. So it'll be held next Saturday the 26th at 1:30 here in the church. If you've got a project that you've been doing or long ago and it's stuck in the wardrobe, bring it out. If you've always wanted to learn how to sew or to knit, come along, bring your items. And if you just want to come and have a bit of fellowship, that's, you know, come along as well. We just ask that you bring a little plate to share of some afternoon tea and come and enjoy. We'd love to see you there. Thank you.
Thanks, Annette. It is now time for us to send the kids out to the children's ministries, their various locations. So if we could have the kids and leaders stand for today. No? Yes, this man's listening. I don't know about the rest of you kids. Anyway, see how we go. So today we have Glenda and Eliza in children's Kids Kingdom room. We've got Jan and Creche and Shane and Fiona up in the Kids Kingdom at the back. Yeah, doing the older kids. These guys have been trained and accredited, and it's great to have you guys serving and learning about Jesus and God in your lives. So let us pray as you go out, and then we shall release you guys to go and do some work and learn some stuff, like we will. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for our children. We thank you for the gift that they are to us, the joy that they bring us, and Father, for the faith that they show us. Lord, you call us all to be your children. And Father, as we teach the ways of your word, Lord, as we lead our young kids in ministry, Father, may you continue to grow us and change us to be more like you. Father, may we know a sense of joy and peace. May we know what it is to have you as our Lord and Savior. Father, may you bless this time in children's ministries. We ask in your name. Amen. So if your kids are ready, off you go. Are you excited? I'm not sure. Adam's more excited, I think. I think Adam was excited. Yeah! Praise the Lord. We're going to hear from the missions team now, but as neither or any of the team are here today, they've done the COVID-friendly Zoom meeting. So take us away, missions team.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to the missions spot today. We can't be there this Sunday, so we're doing it this way. Hopefully this will get the message across. But we'd like to focus today on Myanmar. It's in the news at the moment. It's a current event. And we really need to look at it because of our people in church. So we want to focus on them today. We've heard stories on our Facebook feeds and on the news that there's people hiding in the scrub, there's people hiding in cow sheds and things like that. We also heard stories of, reports in Thailand of being right near the Thailand border, of hearing bombs and things go off over the border in places where me and Jonathan travelled just last year. So it's all getting a bit close to home. And people feel like the West has really forgotten them in many ways. So we want to just remember them today and bring them to the church's attention. Jono?
Thanks. As Peter was saying, there's been some reports about fighting in the areas where we travelled. In particular, we've been contacted by some of our students whom Peter and myself were taught. And these students, one in particular, messaged us with telling us that he had joined the Karen militia and sent us pictures of his local battalion and him in army costume, and just telling us how and sent us a picture of his essentially army school in the jungles at night, and telling us it was pretty tough. We've received reports, as Peter was saying, of how the Burmese military have entered the Karen area just across the border from where we were working. There's been some fierce fighting, which has dramatically escalated over the last couple of months in that area. And so far, the Karen forces, of which some of our students are a part of, have fought apparently admirably through guerrilla warfare in the Burmese highlands. However, there's questions as to how long that can last. So we just wanted to focus in particular, because we've got a real personal connection with soldiers who are actually fighting right now in that area.
All right, and just going into the next point, we did want to read a letter from Pastor Tito in relation to our donation. So I'm just going to read that out. So, to Mount Gambier Baptist Church, pastors, elders, and all church members, word of thanks. On behalf of Kuthuli Hope Theological Seminary, let me say, may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. As mentioned above, I'd like to express my words of thanks and gratitude to the love and care for us shown through your big contribution for the construction of our seminary buildings, such as the women's hostel, men's hostel, and seminary building. As our Karen churches abroad have to focus on the need of our Karen people who have been displaced in Burma, your financial assistance comes in at the right time, so that we do not need to stop constructing. We have already finished two buildings, such as the seminary building and the women's hostel, and we are yet to finish the men's hostels. Sincerely yours, Pastor Tito.
Yeah, thanks, Julia. As Julia was saying in that letter, that the buildings, if you can imagine them, are both two-storey. So there's room for girls' dormitories and the boys in the other building. And the other level at top is used for classrooms, for Bible college classrooms. Their number to build those buildings was $30,000 Australian dollars. And as most of you will know by now, but if you don't, thanks to our quiz night at the start of the year and other donations, we have raised up to $28,000 and they have received that money now. There was a time when they thought they'd have to stop work because of they just run out of cash, and then our donations came through. So we can be very proud of that as a church. We've contributed to that, and we'll show you these pictures of just of this, the school buildings as well, so you can get an idea of the scale. But it's an impressive job, and thanks to everyone for supporting that. They should be used, thanks to our donations, they'll be ready for the start of the school year, which will be, I think it's about August, they start their school year. So thanks very much. Now, please remember, as part of the mission giving, remember these envelopes to give generously. We thank you for your donations. You've been very generous. But we can't support anyone without your help. We can't support our friends in Kazakhstan, Thailand, Burma, Kulthuli Hope, and even local missions. We can't do it without your help. So we thank you for your help so far, and remember us as you give today. And Jonathan's just going to pray to close us out. Sorry, no, Julia's going to pray. I got mixed up on my J's.
Okay.
Julia's going to pray.
All right, let us pray. Dear Lord, we just we thank you for the connection that we as a church have with the Korean people. We thank you for that connection that we have here in Mount Gambier, and we thank you for that connection that we have in Thailand, Lord. I thank you for the donation that has been so generously provided by the people of Mount Gambier Baptist Church and the community of Mount Gambier, Lord. We just thank you for such generous hearts, Lord, and we just praise you that we can see the fruit of that as we hear from those who are in Thailand, that it has made such a difference in their own fellowship and their own mission, Lord. So we just thank you for that, Lord. And we just pray for those who are still in Myanmar, Lord. We pray for Karen people and Kareni people, Lord. We also pray for others in Myanmar who are experiencing persecution, Lord. We pray for your protection over them, Lord. We know that is a very difficult and treacherous situation, Lord, and we just know that despite all this, that you are sovereign and that you are there, Lord. So we just pray for your protection for civilians, Lord, and we just pray that you will just show them that you are with them, Lord. We pray for the church, that you will just rise up the church in the midst of this, that they may support and love the communities that are there, and really show Christ's love, a love that is so self-sacrificial and will put others above ourselves, Lord. We just pray for that, and we just pray for the strength for all the Christians that are in Myanmar, Lord, that you will be with them. Yeah. We also just pray, Lord, that you will continue to work through a resolution of what's happening in Myanmar, Lord. We don't know why it's happening, and we don't really want to see the suffering that is happening, Lord, but we just pray that you would work through the government, Lord, and you would bring about peace in that area, Lord, as only you know how, Lord. Yeah. So again, we just pray for each and every person in Myanmar, Lord, and we just ask that you would just be with them. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And remember to remember our local Karen people who have friends and family living in Myanmar at this time, and there's risk of them getting bombed and attacked. So please keep them in mind. Thank you for listening to us today. We'll see you again next week.
See you later.
Thanks, missions team. They're doing a great job, and may we continue to grow as a church as we support our missions, not only here in the community, but also in Samaria, our Samaria, which is our regions around us, and to the ends of the world, like to overseas missions. So, as we continue to keep our brothers in Millicent in prayer, and continue to serve God in all of our lives as we worship Him. Just going to give you an opportunity now to take up our gifts and offerings. The details will be on the screen and on your screens at home as you're joining with us. And if you are giving online and you want to give to missions, please just put missions next to your giving, and that will go straight to the missions fund. So a normal offering will be as standard, and the envelopes are at the back of the church. But let us just take a moment just to sit in his presence as we give today. May we give with glad hearts. Let us stand. Father, as we give these gifts, may you receive them for your glory. Father, as Ian comes to share the word this morning, may you encourage us and lead us. May you teach us by your word to honor and worship you in all things. As we sing this next song, I just ask you to reflect upon the words that we sing. This hymn is 90 years old, and if you imagine 90 years ago, someone wrote these words, someone penned these words from a heart that was following Christ. And here we are today, still singing of our Jesus who is with us today, tomorrow, and right now. A God who is always with us and continues to be with us. May we praise him.
And all through life.
Father, may we see your face. May we know you as our Lord and Savior. Father, may you call us to the streams of living water. Refresh us anew. Lord, in your word we read that none, if you come to me, you shall not grow weary. You shall not hunger. You shall not thirst. Lord, that you will satisfy our every need. That you will provide for us. In all situations, Lord, you have given all we need here in our hands. Father, as Ian comes to share the word this morning, may you give him the strength, the courage, and the boldness to speak your word, the message you have placed on his heart. Father, may we have ears that hear and hearts that are molded by you. Renew us today, we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Ian.
Good morning. Welcome to those who are watching with us online this morning, and also to the Middleton congregation who will be sharing with us as well. Just before we turn to the Word of God, just one brief announcement. We've been asked by the family of Noel and Gwenda Walker just to let folk know that on Friday evening, Gwenda Walker passed away and has gone to be with the Lord. Many of you will know her. She was a member of this church for 63 years before she and Noel moved to Adelaide for a few years before moving back to Mount Gambier just recently. At this stage, we're not sure of any funeral arrangements, but I'm sure we'll be letting know of that as time goes on. So if you remember Noel and his family as they grieve, along with others who have lost loved ones recently, let's uphold them before the Lord. Shall we bow together in prayer? Our Father, we come as your children, hungering and thirsting to know you better, longing that day by day we might understand the depths of your love, your ways, your purposes, your plans. We come to open your word this morning and ask that as we do so, you will take that word that you have inspired and by the gracious ministry of your Holy Spirit, apply it individually to us today. For we ask it in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. We continue our series of We Want a King, looking at the kings of Israel, mainly Saul and David and Solomon. And today we think of the building of the temple by Solomon. And we read about it in 1 Kings chapters 4 to 9 and 2 Chronicles chapters 1 to 7. Now I'd love to spend the time to read all those chapters to you, but obviously it isn't going to happen today. But I would recommend to you that you take the time to read them for yourselves, just to catch something of the splendour of what happened. King David had died. Solomon was now king. God had met with him and said to him, "Ask whatever you want and I will give it to you." We know the story, of course, and history records for us that Solomon asked for wisdom. He said, "Give me wisdom to know how to rule this people, how to be a king that will guide his people rightly." And God said, because you've asked for wisdom, I'll not only give you that, but I'll give you everything else beside. And when you read the record of Solomon, he was probably one of the wealthiest men the world has ever seen. And he was established in his kingdom. His wisdom became well known around the whole of the then known world. People came from as far away as Africa to listen to him and to gain help and strength from the wise things that he did. He wrote, of course, the book of Proverbs and the book of Song of Solomon and many other books that he wrote as well, which are not recorded for us. His kingdom was established. His name Solomon means peaceful. And during his reign, Israel was at peace. Mind you, he had a pretty big army to make sure that happened, but it was peaceful. And during that time of Solomon's reign was the only time in the history of the nation of Israel up until this point. Future events may change that. But the only time when the nation of Israel occupied all the land that was promised to Abraham. And his kingdom was established. And then he decided to build a temple. Not just a temple, he built a lot of other things as well. He built a palace for himself. He built a judgment hall. He built a throne hall and other public buildings. And we get, unfortunately, a taste of maybe things going wrong when he also built a palace for one of his wives, one of his 300 wives, who was the daughter of Pharaoh. Now, we could have an archaeology lesson this morning and spend all our time looking at the building itself and the types of things that all under the good hand of God and God's redemptive plan were types and pictures of things that would be fulfilled in Christ. But the more we read this story, we begin to understand that it isn't really about the building. It's about worship. So today, as we think of the building of the Temple of Solomon, we will consider the essence of worship and see what we can learn. We can ask ourselves, what is worship? When our Lord Jesus spoke to the Samaritan woman at the well of Sychar, what did he mean when he said, when confronted by the woman's argument about where God should be worshipped? He said, the hour is coming when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem worship the Father. But the hour cometh and now is when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. God's intended purpose for humanity was that we should be worshippers. We were made to worship God. When God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness, it was in order that he could have fellowship with us. It was obviously done so that the incarnation, the coming of God becoming man, could be possible. Possible that a human substitute could pay the sacrifice for sin. And you and I were created for one purpose, to be worshippers. Everything else flows out from that. Our service, our obedience, our ministry, our life are all byproducts of God's intended purpose that we worship him. Unfortunately, we know the story only too well, and we see it reflected in our own hearts too often, that we turned to worship other gods but him. And the essence of sin is not the fact that we commit adultery, we kill, we murder, we spit and chew. The essence of sin is that we worship ourselves instead of God. The essence of sin is that self rules on the throne of our hearts instead of God. But the essence of worship is that we give God his rightful place in our lives. So what is worship? Is worship the singing of hymns, the prayer, the praise, the offerings that we bring? The words that are used in the scriptures mean those things. Some of the words in the Greek in the New Testament that are translated worship are actually words for service and for offering. But these things are the way we express our worship. They are not worship in themselves. The Hebrew word for worship means to prostrate oneself, to crouch down, to bow down, to bow self down, to reverence, to humbly beseech, to fall down flat. That's the Old Testament word, the Hebrew word, to prostrate oneself, to bow self down. And the Greek word means to prostrate oneself in homage. And the overwhelming meaning of the Greek word for worship is adoration. It also means to revere, to reverence, to give reverence to. It also means to kiss the hand, as in giving obeisance to a monarch, to take their hand and to kiss it in a sense of reverence, a sense of respect. And I was amazed to discover that the word in the Greek has a root word that means like a dog licking its master's hand. Now, over the years, we've had a number of dogs in our family. We've had black ones and brown ones and brindle ones. We've had good ones and bad ones. We've had thoroughbreds and mongrels. We've had large ones and little ones. But they all had one thing in common. We didn't have any inside dogs, but they were outside dogs. They lived in kennels. They had one thing in common, that when we went out in the morning and let them out of their enclosure, or we came home from somewhere and they were in the yard, and they'd always greet us by rushing to us and licking us. And with a posture that was not aggressive, certainly boisterous, but a posture that said, "You're the boss, and I'm so glad to see you again. Where have you been all night? Where have you been all day? Why have you left me alone by myself all the time? I just love you so much. I'd lick you to death if I had a chance." That's worship, according to the Bible. That's worship. Seeing God as the most important person in our life. Seeing God as the one who is worthy of all our adoration, all our praise, all the deep longings of our heart. And so let's look at the building of the temple and see what we can learn about worship. The first thing we see is the intention to worship. When Hiram, king of Tyre, heard that Solomon had been anointed king to succeed his father David, he sent his envoys to Solomon because he had always been on friendly terms with David. Solomon sent back this message to him, to Hiram. "You know that because of the wars waged against my father, David, from all sides, he could not build a temple for the name of the Lord his God until the Lord put his enemies under his feet. But now the Lord my God has given me rest on every side, and there is no adversary or disaster. I intend, therefore, to build a temple for the name of the Lord my God, as the Lord told my father David when he said, 'Your son, whom I will put on the throne in your place, will build the temple for my name. So give orders that cedars of Lebanon be cut for me. My men will work with yours. I will pay you for your men's whatever wages you set. You know that we have no one so skilled in felling timber as the Sidonians. When Hiram heard Solomon's message, he was greatly pleased and said, "Praise be to the Lord today, for he has given David a wise son to rule over this great nation. I intend, therefore, to build a temple for the name of the Lord my God." Solomon intentionally set himself to lead the nation in worship with the desire to build a temple to the glory of God. Intentional worship comes from our knowledge of God and our subsequent desire to be his worshippers. Unfortunately, such holy intentions often missing in the churches of our Western society today because of two things. One, we don't know God as we should. And because we don't know him, we have a subsequent lack of reverence for him. You know, I speak in general terms. Thank God for his remnant that he has that's always present. But how we need to know God with an intention to worship him. Different research has shown that a huge percentage of professing Christians in the Western world never read their Bibles from one Sunday to the next. One survey found that 80% of Protestants don't read their Bibles every day. We starve ourselves. We wouldn't dream of going without meals during the day. Yet we starve our souls. We starve our lives of a knowledge of God because we don't read his word. I heard of a lady once who said, well, she didn't need to read her Bible every day because she'd read it once. We forget that this word is not a novel. God's word is not a book that we just read once and then forget about. God's word is a living, breathing way of communicating with his people. It's described itself as being light, as a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces, as milk, as bread, as meat, sweeter than honey, something that gives comforts, the sword of the spirit that divides between soul and spirit. And we need to read it and to learn of it. We need to ask him to reveal himself and his ways to us. There's a very significant verse, which I know I've quoted here before, in Psalm 103 and verse 7. God made his ways known unto Moses, his acts or gifts to the people of Israel. And there's a big difference. The people of Israel were quite happy to receive the miracles. They were quite happy to receive the bread. They were quite happy to receive the water. They were happy to see God do things for them. But as soon as things got tough, because they didn't know his ways, they didn't understand his heart, they rebelled against him. They turned away from him. They forgot him. But we're told that Moses knew God's ways, the way he travels, the things he does. We need to know him both in private, in our prayer, in our praise. And the way to do that is to ask him to teach us of himself. Ask and you shall receive, the Lord Jesus said. Seek and you shall find. Knock and go on knocking and it will be opened unto you. And if we are serious about knowing God, then we need to spend time in his word regularly, taking the time to wait upon him, to meditate upon his word, to allow his word to speak to us day by day. Some years ago, I was working in a ward in a hospital that I once worked at, and it was morning tea time. And as usual, the staff were sitting around having their cup of tea and gossiping and talking about this, that and the other thing. And there was one lady there. She was the lady who was in charge of all the domestic duties of the ward. And she was a real character, one of these people that always sort of brightened up your day. But she was also one of these people that seemed to know everybody's business. And on one occasion, I remember one of the registered nurses said to her, "Do you know Mrs. So-and-so?" She thought for a moment, then she said, "Oh, you mean that lady that lives down on such and such a street, the red brick house with the grey roof, and husband works for such and such a factory, and the children go to this school, the same school that my kids go to actually, but they're different classes than my kids, and they drive a blue Monaro, and she works part-time such and such, and they're all involved with one of the football clubs, and she named the club and the netball club." No, she said, "I don't know her." She knew all about her, but she didn't know her. It's awfully possible, as children of God, to be like the Israelites, to know all about God. We've been taught about him since we were children, and we've come to know him. We know that he forgives our sin. We know that one day we'll be in heaven with him. We know that he is supposed to hear and answer prayer, but we don't really know him. But if we come and set ourselves to know him, we ask him to know him, his word will become so precious and he will become so real that we know it's true when he says he holds us in the hollow of his hand. His left hand is under my head. His right hand embraces me. We'll know it's true when he said, "I will never, ever leave you nor forsake you." We know it's true when he said, "If you come to me, I'll not cast you out. I will comfort you. I will meet your needs." We know it's true when he says that in everything he will supply what we need. That if he says you cast your burden on me, I will sustain you. It's all the difference in knowing that in our heads and knowing that in our hearts. And discovering every day some precious truth about him that strengthens us, that enables us to worship him and to love him. For such knowledge will affect the way we live. It will affect the things we do. Not by comparing ourselves to others, not by comparing our spiritual life to other Christians, not excusing ourselves when we do things perhaps that we shouldn't do, but by faith taking hold of his word and trusting him. And he will teach us to worship deep in our own hearts. And then corporately, because we don't know the scriptures, and by that I mean knowing them in actual working order, we so often miss worship ourselves as we come together. When we come together as a church, there are many motives that we have for coming to church, many facets of a church life, fellowship, friendship, and the two are not necessarily the same. Children's ministries, singing, Bible studies, all kinds of activities that we involve in. But the primary reason we come as God's people is that we come to worship together. The Lord Jesus said on one occasion in Matthew chapter 18, "If two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything, it will be done for them by my Father which is in heaven." Because he says, "Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." Now we've heard that verse quoted many, many times. But when you come to church on a Sunday morning, do you actually believe that? When we come to worship, do we come with that burning intention to meet with Jesus? Often we come at the beginning of a service, we come probably in the same almost frame of mind as if we were going to the cinema or the opera. And we wait for the show to begin. And then we hope that the worship team can do their job and somehow lift us into the presence of God. But if I read my Bible right, and if I know the Word of God right, that's not how it works. When we come as a collective body of people, Jesus is here. We don't have to call him down from heaven. We don't have to do things somehow to make him take notice of us. He has said, if you gather together in my name, I am there. I am here. What a difference it would make to our worship, I believe, if we came each Sunday morning as a collective people with that motive in our hearts, with that knowledge in our hearts. I'm going today to worship with God's people, to see Jesus who walks amongst the candlesticks, who knows this church better than it knows itself. And I will come and worship him at his invitation. The level of our worship will never rise any higher than the level of our knowledge of our God. Then as we move on, we find Solomon preparing to worship. The temple I'm going to build will be great because our God is greater than all other gods. But who is able to build a temple for him, since the heavens, even the highest heaven, cannot contain him? Who am I to build a temple for him except as a place to burn sacrifices before him? I can't build a house to contain God, says Solomon, but I can build a house in which I can worship him. I can prepare a place of worship. In 1 Chronicles chapter 22, David had said, my son Solomon is young and inexperienced, and the house to be built for the Lord should be of great magnificence and fame and splendor in the sight of all nations. Therefore, I will make preparations for it. So David made extensive preparations before his death. David says, nothing is too good to prepare for my God. In the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel, in the month of Ziv, the second month, he began to build the temple of the Lord. The temple that King Solomon built for the Lord was 60 cubits long, that's 90 feet, 30 feet wide and 45 feet high. The portico at the front of the main hall of the temple extended the width of the temple, that is 20 cubits, and projected 10 cubits from the front of the temple. Against the walls of the main hall and inner sanctuary, he built a structure around the building in which there were side rooms. He made offset ledges around the outside of the temple, so that nothing would be inserted into the temple walls. In building the temple, only blocks dressed at the quarry were used, and no hammer, chisel, or any other iron tool was heard at the temple site while it was being built. It would have been an eerie silence to watch. No noise of machinery, no noise of steel, and all those great stones cut in the quarries, and then brought in and put in their place. The temple was built of quarried stone, local stone. The inside was lined with cedar woods from Lebanon. And most of the walls and the floors were then lined with gold. And during that building, God appeared to Solomon, we're told, to encourage him to go on following him and building. King Solomon sent to Tyre and brought Huram, who was filled with wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, to do all kinds of bronze work. He came to King Solomon, did all the work assigned to him. Two pillars, the two bowl-shaped capitals on top of the pillars. The two sets of network decorating the two bowl-shaped capitals on the top of the pillars. The 400 pomegranates for decorating the bowl-shaped capitals on the top of the pillars. The 10 stands with 10 basins. The sea and the 12 bulls under it. The pots, the shovels, the sprinkling bowls. All these objects that Hiram made for King Solomon for the building of the temple of the Lord were of burnished bronze. Solomon left all these things unweighed because there were so many. The weight of the bronze was not determined. Solomon also made the furnishings that were in the Lord's temple, the golden altar, the golden table on which there was the bread of the presence, the lampstands of pure gold, the gold floral work, the lamps and tongs, the pure gold basins, wicks, trimmers, sprinkling bowls, dishes and censers, and the gold sockets for the doors of the inmost room, the most holy place, and also for the doors of the main hall of the temple. When all the work King Solomon had done for the temple of the Lord was finished, he brought in the things that his father David had dedicated, the silver, the gold, the furnishings. He placed them in the treasures of the Lord's temple. The altar, 9.1 metres square, 4.5 metres high. The sea of washing, the ornaments. So much stuff that it's estimated by current people that probably the cost ran into billions of dollars. Not just the gold and the silver and the bronze, but the wages for the all the people doing the work, 30,000 of them cutting the timbers. 10,000 a month, they do a month in Lebanon and then 2 months at home. 70,000 people that carted things, the 80,000 people that cut the stones, the 3,500 foremen, plus all the filigree work, plus all the artisans. Huge, huge cost. Because as far as Solomon and David was concerned, nothing could be too good for their God. They needed to have the best of everything. Why? Simply because he is a great, big, wonderful God. Creator, sustainer, covenant keeping. Covenants under which we still live today. Our world reels under all kinds of pressures today. People are worried about global warming and the planet running out of resources. And as Christians, of course, we should do all we can to preserve our planet, to do all we can and all we should do to be good stewards of this world in which God has placed us. But you know, after the flood, God made a covenant with Noah, a covenant that has never been rescinded. There were two covenants in the Old Testament that have never changed. One was the Noahic covenant, the covenant that God made with you and me, with humanity. The other, the covenant that God made with David, that there would be a man on his throne forever, referring, of course, to the Lord Jesus. But in that covenant that he made with Noah, God said to this, as long as the earth remains, summer and winter, cold and heat, seed time and harvest, day and night, will not cease. That is God's promise. And until God comes and winds things up, our world will continue. Because it's not our planet, it's God's planet. It's God's creation. He has made it, for he is the Almighty One. He is sovereign. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's also patient and merciful and gracious. He's abundant in loyal love and truth and faithfulness. He's one who can be trusted absolutely. One who is forgiving, comforting, protective, just and holy. And we can only stand back in awe and say with Job, whatever we know of God, These are but the edges of his ways, just the mere edges of his ways. And nothing is too good for him. And that's why the Apostle Paul calls us in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, and says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable, your rational service. And don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing or renovating of your mind, that you might prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The only way that we can truly prepare for true worship is by a total surrender of our will to God's will. To know the secret of the Lord Jesus, who trusted his Father implicitly, and he relied only on him. True worship within us can only happen when we truly make Jesus Lord. The level of our worship will never rise any higher than the level of our surrender to God. The temple was built. The intention had been carried out. The preparation had been done. Now it was time for worship. The center of worship, the presence of Almighty God. And King Solomon summoned into his presence at Jerusalem the elders of Israel, all the heads of the tribes, the chief of the Israelite families, to bring up the Ark of the Lord's Covenant from Zion, the city of David. All the Israelites came together to King Solomon at the time of the festival in the month of Ethanim, the seventh month. When all the elders of Israel had arrived, the priests took up the ark, and they brought up the ark of the Lord and the tent of meeting and all the sacred furnishings in it. The priests and the Levites carried them up. And King Solomon, the entire assembly of Israel that had gathered about him, were before the ark, sacrificing so many sheep and cattle they couldn't be recorded or counted. They obviously remember the time that David sought to move the ark and had done so at his own strength. And the second time round, made offerings every few metres, every few yards as they progressed. The priest then brought the Ark of the Lord's Covenant to its place in the inner sanctuary of the temple, the most holy place, and put it beneath the wings of the cherubim. The cherubim spread their wings over the place of the Ark and overshadowed the Ark and its carrying poles. These poles were so long that their ends could be seen from the holy place in front of the inner sanctuary, but not from outside the holy place. And they are still there today. That would be to the time of writing. There was nothing in the ark except the two stone tablets that Moses had placed in it at Horeb, where the Lord made a covenant with the Israelites after they came out of Egypt. When the priests withdrew from the holy place, the cloud filled the temple of the Lord. And the priests could not perform their service because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled his temple. The wholeness of worship is only known when the presence of God is central. And you might say, well, that's pretty obvious. But unfortunately, again, often in our Western society, that is not always the case. Often there are other competing gods for worship. Personalities often take central place. We have to worship in such a way to make sure the mood is right, to get the sound and the light effects right. Things that appeal to the sensual emotions, somehow to bring us to a place of meditating upon God. Emotions are extremely important in worship. If worshipping God doesn't bring us to tears or to laughter or to both at the same time, then we know little of worship. But we must never put the cart before the horse. We don't come to worship to somehow summon up some kind of psychological advantage where we feel or try to feel the presence of God. We come and we worship Him with our wills, with what we know to be true of Him. And He then reveals Himself to us. And the most emotional experiences I've ever had in my life have been times when God has touched something in my life, either to show me some sin that needs to be sorted out or given me some victory that He's won in my life. And then the tears flow, the laughter comes. But as in most things in life, when we try and put the cart before the horse, we end up going backwards. And to try and somehow come and try and feel our way into the presence of God is a complete waste of time. The Bible says to be still and know that I am God. We can rest still in His presence, but by our wills come to worship Him. And why do I say that? Because I've heard of atheists who can testify to the same kind of experiences that some Christians say they have in trying to think about God. Atheists can have the same feeling, the same emotional response listening to classical music. It's nothing to do with the Spirit of God. It's to do with sensual emotions, things that please the flesh. But when we come and set our will to worship, our intent to worship, we prepare for worship by understanding and knowing who God is, all the emotion will come when we understand just how great is our God. So where is the presence of God today for His people? No longer does the Shekinah glory glow between the cherubim in the temple, nor is there any building made with man's hands, a place where God lives. God doesn't live here in this church. This is just a place that's been built for us to worship in. The Apostle Paul says to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, don't you know that your body is the temple of God? Whose temple you are not your own. You have been bought with a price. Isaiah 66, one of my favorite verses in the Bible. God says, heaven is my throne. The earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you will build me? And where is the place of my rest? Where do I choose to live? Where do I choose to feel at home? For I have made all these things. But to this one, to this person will I look, to the one that is a poor and of a contrite heart and who trembles at my word. God chooses to live in the life of people. The Bible also uses other pictures. It refers to God's dwelling place as a garden where He can come and enjoy His pleasant fruits. As a home where He can come and feel comfortable. If this morning you're a child of God and you're trusting in Him for forgiveness and you know what it is to be His child, then the Spirit of God lives in you. Have we really understood that truth? Do we really believe that? That's what the Bible teaches. That's what God tells us is true. He dwells in your body, in my body, in my mind, in my spirit. In Revelation chapter 3:20, He speaks to a church that had drifted away from Him. And He said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him, will have a meal with him, and he with me. He says to us today, I want to dwell in you by faith. And okay, things aren't going all that well at the moment, but I want to come back. He says, you provide the space and I'll fill it. You provide the table and I'll bring the feast. Now tell me, Have you ever had a better offer than that? Almighty God, maker of heaven and earth, says to you and me today, open the door of your life to me. Make space for me, and I'll come in and bring all my life, all my provisions, all that I am into your life, in order that you might walk in fellowship with me. The Lord Jesus is always presented in the scriptures as Lord, never just as Saviour. He's presented as Lord, and we're asked to surrender to him as Lord. He becomes our Saviour to make that possible. And corporately, again, as we worship as God's people, let's remember, as we've said before, he is present. A great debate ruled over the centuries about where is the presence of Christ in the communion feast. There are some who say the presence of Christ is in the bread and in the wine. Others who say, no, it's not in it, it's under it. But the presence of Christ is in neither. The presence of Christ at the communion table is in the fellowship and the company of God's people. For he is there in our midst. And when we come together with no other motive than to worship him, we will know joy like we've never known before. Because the level of our worship will never rise any higher than the level to which we surrender to the presence of God in our lives. At the centre of worship also is obedience. The Lord has kept the promise he made, says Solomon. I have succeeded David, my father, and now I sit on the throne of Israel, just as the Lord promised. I have built the temple for the name of the Lord God of Israel. I have provided a place for the ark in which the covenant of the Lord, in which is the covenant of the Lord that he made with our ancestors when he brought them out of Egypt. Obedience. Solomon's admission was that he'd done what was required of him. Unlike Saul, who had to be told, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to listen to God's voice than the fat of rams. Our Lord Jesus says to us today, if you love me, keep my commandments. The essence of true worship is that our Father's will is done. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let's be clear, though, that obedience is not legalism. Legalism is doing or not doing certain things in an effort to gain God's favour, to add to the finished work of Jesus. Unfortunately, there are times when we know Jesus has paid the debt, but for some reason or other, we still think we've got to pay a bit of interest on it. No, he paid it all. But obedience in worship is the loving, voluntary, spontaneous response of a worshipping heart. And the level of our worship will never rise any higher than the level of our obedience to the revealed will of God in and through our Lord Jesus. And then Solomon knew what it was to bring supplication to God. And now, God of Israel, let your word that you have promised your servant David, my father, come true. But will God really dwell on earth? The heavens, even the highest heaven, cannot contain you. How much this temple which I have built? Yet give attention to your servant's prayer and his plea for mercy, Lord my God. Hear the cry and prayer that your servant is praying in your presence this day. May your eyes be open toward this temple day and night, this place of which you said, my name shall be there, so that you will hear the prayer that your servant prays toward this place. Hear the supplication of your servant of your people Israel when they pray toward this place. Hear from heaven your dwelling place, and when you hear, forgive. May I commend to you the reading of all of his prayer. He supplicated God. He worshipfully requests of him to receive their prayers that are offered in that place. Please listen and meet our need. And then he said, if things like if we have famine and we pray from this place, hear and give us a blessing. If our enemies come against us in war, or we have plagues or problems, or even if we backslide in the sin, hear from this place. Because supplication is the asking and requesting of our Father in an attitude of worship. Expression of complete dependence and confidence in our God and his faithfulness, goodness and mercy. And for a child of God, the will to know him. The more we grow, the thoughts of his might, power and justice begin to turn to expressions of awe, rather at his faithfulness and love. Maybe today I'm speaking to someone and you don't really know God. You've never put your trust in the Lord Jesus. Your life was taken up with the worship of other gods. Money, position, reputation, possessions. For we are all worshippers. We will worship something. The things that fill our hearts and our minds, the things that we try desperately to think about so that we don't think about eternal things. But every now and again, in a more solemn moment, a quietness of our hearts, the thoughts sneak into our mind, and if we're honest with ourselves, we know and we see only an angry God above us, a roaring conscience within us, and a yawning hell beneath us. Come with Solomon and say, have mercy upon me, O God. And he will honour that desire. And he will make of us different people. And Solomon dedicated the place. Let this place be one where we see your glorious ways fulfilled. Let my life be like that. Paul says in Philippians, let me lay hold of all that for which the Lord Jesus has laid hold of me. Let me know in my life, fulfill your purposes in my life to the maximum of what you had in mind when you saved me. That's a wonderful prayer. Fulfill in my life to the maximum all that you planned when you saved me. The level of our worship will rise no higher than the level of our expectancy of God's great purposes through his people. And the king and all Israel with him offered sacrifices before the Lord. Solomon offered a sacrifice of fellowship offerings to the Lord. 22,000 cattle, 120,000 sheep and goats. So the king and all Israel dedicated the temple of God. That sacrifice was required under the old covenant, under the law, as substitution. We no longer needed sacrifices of animals to atone for sin because the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. And yet paradoxically, as worshippers, as followers of Jesus, as members of the body of the Church of the Firstborn, sacrifice is a major part of worship. Not to atone for our sin, but as a joyful expression of worship. David on one occasion said, shall I offer to the Lord that which costs me nothing? We often think of sacrifice as what we have to give up. But sacrifice in a worshiping sense is not what we have to give up, but what can I offer to God that will bring pleasure to him? There was a leader of an opposition party in a country recently who'd been exiled from her country and separated from her family and suffered all kinds of hardships. And a reporter interviewed her and said, has it been worth the sacrifice? To which she answered, when you really believe in something, there is no such word as sacrifice. Sacrifice to God as his children is only difficult for our proud flesh. When self continues to get in the way, it rebels against it. sacrifice becomes the willing desire of a worshipping heart when we begin to understand it's not about us, but something that is more very precious to our Heavenly Father and to our Lord Jesus, a sweet-smelling offering to Him. The Bible speaks of three ways of worshipful sacrifice. One we've dealt with, where Paul says, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, our lives as an instrument of worship, an instrument of service for Him. I discovered too that in the Old Testament, in three places, the Bible speaks about the sacrifices of righteousness. We get a bit scared by that word righteousness. It sort of sounds a bit far off, a bit too goody-goody. But all it means basically is just doing things God's way. Doing things God's way as a part of worship, a sacrifice of righteousness. Next Sunday we have a baptismal service. There are people here who deep down know they probably should be baptized. Perhaps you've thought about baptism and I'm not ready for baptism yet. I'm not sure whether I really need to be baptized or want to be baptized. Now we ask ourselves the wrong questions. When the Ethiopian man was preached to by Philip and believed the word of God, they came, we're told, to a place in the chariot ride, a place where obviously there was a large lake. And the Ethiopian man's response was not, am I ready for baptism, or should I think about baptism, or, but there's water here. What is stopping me being baptized? If you profess to be a follower of Jesus, then you need to ask yourself that question. What is stopping me being baptized? If you ask the other questions, it gives too much room for the flesh to say, well, actually, if I'm honest with myself, I'm too proud to get baptized. Or I'm too nervous to get baptized. Or I don't want to make a fool of myself. Baptism is the way that God has ordained that we give testimony, public testimony, to the fact that Jesus is our Lord. Because when we're baptized, we give public testimony to His death, His burial, and His resurrection. It means that we're changing places. When the Lord Jesus came to be baptized by John, it was for a different reason. It was a baptism of repentance, but He was identifying Himself with sinful men. And John said, you should be baptizing me, not me baptizing you. And Jesus said, now it is time for us to fulfill all righteousness, to do things God's way, bringing to Him the sacrifice of righteousness. Another way in which we bring that sacrifice is in our daily round. We have many problems, many difficulties, all of them specific to us. And I think of that verse in 1 Corinthians where it says that testings come, that trials come, such as is common to man. And there is nothing that you and I will suffer, no loss, no pain, no problem that isn't shared by every other person in the world in some way or another. But by the grace of God, He enables us to triumph in it. The Lord Jesus said on one occasion, if you want to follow me, take up your cross and follow me. And I've heard people say, well, my cross is my sick child. My cross is the cancer that I have. My cross is the bereavement that I've suffered. No, it's not. They're just burdens that everybody shares. In the book of Galatians, it uses the word burdens twice in chapter 6. It almost sounds like a contradiction. In one place it says, share one another's burdens. And then just a few lines down it says, everyone shall bear their own burden. There are two different Greek words there. There are some things that we can help one another with, but there are some burdens that are specific to us that nobody else can touch. And the Greek word actually means to pay an invoice. It's got our name on it. It's made specifically for us, like a bill, an invoice. But even that is not our cross. The cross of Christ is how we react to that burden. The cross of Christ is how we react to the problems of life. And I may feel sick. I may feel as though it's hardly worth putting one foot after another. It doesn't give me the right to feel sorry for myself or the right to take it out on someone else in a bad temper or whatever, because that is the sacrifice of righteousness, of doing the right thing, whatever the circumstances, by the grace of God. We often hear people saying, oh, God helps me to cope with each day. No, he doesn't. He didn't call you to cope. He called us to triumph. He called us to make sure that people saw him, not our own failures. And then in Hebrews it talks about offering to God the sacrifice of praise. Whatever the circumstances, whatever the situation, to offer him praise in the situation. Not to say, why me? Why is God doing this in anger and frustration? Not to say, oh, I will praise him through gritted teeth, but worshipfully, gladly, bringing to him the sacrifice of praise. And we were prepared to submit to the will of God in every situation. Believe you me, we will worship like we've never worshipped before. Because the level of our worship will be proportionate to the offerings of the sacrifice we bring. And then at the centre of worship was celebration. So Solomon observed the festival at that time, all Israel with him, a vast assembly. They celebrated it before the Lord our God for 7 days and seven more days, 14 days in all. On the following day he sent the people away. They blessed the king and then went home joyful and glad in their hearts for all the good things the Lord had done for his servant and his people Israel. Again, we celebrate both personally and corporately. As we worship, we celebrate the goodness of our God and his faithfulness, his compassion, his patience, his loyal love, his trustworthiness, his sovereignty, his good forgiveness, and all the other gifts of his love. Lifting our hearts, minds, and wills and voices in praise and adoration. And the level of our worship will be in direct proportion to the level at which we stop concentrating on ourselves and begin to celebrate on all the wonders of God. And as they came to the end of their celebrations, they came to the rewarding intimacy of worship. We won't read it all for the sense of time, but God met with Solomon as he worshipped, and said, I've heard your prayer. And even if your descendants and you turn away, if you come back, I'll forgive you. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Rewarding intimacy of fellowship. Sadly, history records for us that both Solomon and the nation did turn their backs on God. They were harassed and defeated and enslaved by the very nations whose gods they came to worship. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death, But the wages of sin is also our sin. And the things we do catch up with us. The temple was destroyed. The God will not be mocked. In the churches of Revelation, he said, I'll remove your candlestick from its place. God's holiness demands that his worshippers be holy. And so he promises to meet with us as we worship him. And he says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, from the things that separate me from them, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. And so the temple was built. The worship had begun. Holy God can only be reached in one place. The Shekinah glory was there between the cherubim. Under the Old Testament, the veil was in place so that people couldn't go in to the holy place. The law and its severity kept them out. But we know that things are different now. What has changed? What has changed? Behold, a greater than Solomon is here. Because Almighty God, maker of heaven and earth, the awesome, holy, sovereign, the one who made us in his image and likeness, did what he asks us to do. He humbled himself and he sent forth his beloved Son. And that beloved Son, being in the form and the nature of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, something to be grasped at for his own advantage, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form and the nature of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. He lived a perfect life as a perfect human being in complete dependence on his Father. He became the perfect sacrifice when he died at Calvary. And one drop of that precious blood that seeped into that gory scaffold was more efficacious, more able to wash and cleanse than all the blood of Solomon's 20,000 cattle and 120,000 sheep and goats. And when he died, that great veil, estimated in Herod's temple to be 60 feet high and the width of a man's hand wide, thick, was torn in two, thus showing that the way was opened into the presence of God. Through him we have perfect acceptance. The Father accepted his sacrifice and was satisfied, the prophet tells us. He's now a perfect high priest, now in heaven for us. And we need to live in that reality. Live as children, heirs, joint heirs with Christ, coming boldly to worship into the very throne room, to take up our inheritance day by day. But you know, there's more. Wherefore God also has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth, that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. There is coming a day when worship will be perfect, when people not only should give him praise, but all creation will give him praise. Are we looking for that day? Or is the center of our worship still on the things that we can see and handle? But to see him face to face with Christ, my Savior, face to face, what will it be when with rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ, who died for me? To kneel at his feet, to worship no longer by faith but by sight, never able to sin against him anymore. To be satisfied with anything less is to be content with an engagement ring rather than getting married, because the Holy Spirit is the earnest of our inheritance. The best that we can have at this time is to be engaged to Christ. Then on that day, we shall be joined with him at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Our Father in heaven, let your name be hallowed. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Shall we spend a few moments in silent prayer as we personally worship him? Maybe just giving him thanks. Or if he touches something in your life that needs to be put right, do it straight away. Listen to the words of his mother when he performed his first miracle, when she said to him, to the people, whatever he tells you to do, do it. Spend just a few moments in silence, and then I'll lead us in prayer, and then we'll sing our last wonderful hymn together, a wonderful song, How Deep the Father's Love. Shall we pray? Almighty God and loving Heavenly Father, we come as your children, as your heirs, even joint heirs with the Lord Jesus, to worship you, to tell you that we love you, that we adore you, to praise you and to thank you for your loyal love, your utter and complete faithfulness, and for your wondrous ability to satisfy the deep longings of our hearts. Let your name be hallowed. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Sons to glory.
go in the grace and the peace of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. And feel free to come forward and speak to someone this morning, or if you want prayer for this morning, please come forward and we'll pray with you. God bless.